Up till now, we have only seen single models. Now we will understand how to deal with assembly models. Whenever we are working with assemblies, we need to define the contacts between the two components or geometries. The advantage we have in ANSYS Workbench mechanical window is that these assembly contacts are automatically defined. Wherever two bodies are in contact, a contact region is defined over there. So the user does not have to manually define the contacts. So this is one of the greatest advantages we have in ANSYS Workbench. Now let us understand how these contacts are defined. We will open one assembly. Let us open one assembly in ANSYS Workbench. I will import one assembly over here. And now we will enter into the mechanical window. Once we come to the mechanical window, you can see the assembly that has been imported. The assembly has all these parts over here, and the parts are renamed. If you see very carefully, the parts are renamed. Renaming the parts in the assembly is very, very important. Suppose if you import the assembly and the parts are not renamed, if you are getting it as part 1, part 2, part 3, part 4, please go to the geometry design modeler again. You can come to the design modeler and you can rename all these parts again. It is very, very important that you rename the parts, because when you open the contact regions will be defined according to the part name. If you see this image over here, okay, can you see the contact region which is defined is, you can see the contact body names over here. In this image, you can see that the part name is caster axle and caster wheel. So if the names are written, it becomes very easy for the user to understand where exactly is the contact. So now in this assembly, the parts are already renamed. And now if you see, you have one extra option over here that is called as connections. If we expand this connections option over here, you will have one more option inside that is called as contacts. And if you click on this, all the contact regions you can see over here. So automatically we can see that there are almost 30 contact regions that are there. Or 38, it is 29. You have somewhere around 29 contact regions. Now, where exactly are these contact regions defined? So if you click on contact region, you will see that in details of the contact region, you will see where exactly is that contact defined. So now you can see that this contact is between valve cover bolt and the valve housing. So if you see valve cover bolt and valve housing, these are the components. So it is between the valve housing and the bolts. So we have three bolts over here. So it is over there. So this contact region is between the bolt and the housing. Then we have contact region 2, which is between the cover bolt and the cover. Then we have contact region 3, which is between the cover bolt and the arm. If you see, this is the contact which is getting defined. So like this, you can see all the contacts that are defined automatically. So this is what we are talking about in the PPT, that wherever there is a contact, or wherever there are two geometries that are touching each other, there the contact region will be defined automatically. Now let us understand what are the types of contacts. Now we have already understood that the contacts are defined automatically. Now we will understand the types of contacts. So in the types of contacts, we basically have five major types of contacts, that is bonded contact, no separation, frictional, frictionless, and rough. So there are five types of contacts, and these contact types are visible over here. If you see, if you select any contact region in the details window, you will see that where exactly is this contact. You will see the part names plus you will see the type. So these are the five types of contacts that we are talking about. Okay, now let us understand what is the meaning of each and every contact. So let us talk about the first contact that we have, that is the bonded contact. The bonded constraint is the default contact defined between the surfaces. So this is the default contact which is defined between all the surfaces. Now these whatever contact regions have come automatically, everywhere you will see that it is a bonded contact. So bonded contact is actually the default contact that gets applied to all the contact surfaces. It can get defined between surfaces, solids, lines, faces, edges. It behaves like a glue contact where the two surfaces are not allowed to slide nor separate. So wherever there is a bonded contact, the surfaces act as if they are glued to each other and there is no sliding allowed nor there is any separation between them. For example, if you have two surfaces between which this contact is defined, what happens is they are not allowed to slide nor they will separate from each other. If you take an example, suppose if you have two plates between which there are gaps, or if there is penetration between the two plates. Now if I want that these two plates should not move with respect to each other, you can assign a bonded contact. So even if there is a gap, there is a visual gap between the two plates, but still I want to say that these two plates should not move about each other, you can apply a bonded contact over there. So that means even if the plates don't touch each other and still I want to say that they are not going to move nor slide, you can assign a bonded contact. Similarly, if there are two plates which are intersecting or penetrating with each other, but still I want to say that there is no sliding, no separation, I can directly say that it is a bonded contact. Okay, so that is nothing but a bonded contact. Next, we will talk about no separation. The no separation contact is similar to the bonded contact, where the two surfaces can slide a little but they cannot separate. Please understand, these two surfaces, wherever you have given a no separation contact, they can slide very little with respect to each other but they cannot separate from each other. You can use this contact when you are very sure that the load applied to these plates would always be in such a manner that these surfaces will not separate. That means when can we use this no separation contact is if there are two plates and I am applying some load on them. If I am very sure that that load that I have applied will not cause any separation between the two plates, there I can very clearly use no separation contact. And in this contact we are saying that there is very little sliding allowed. So the sliding allowed in this contact is frictionless, but the sliding is very, very limited. It is a very limited sliding that we get in no separation. Okay, after that we will move to the next contact, which is frictional contact. Now in this contact type, the two contacting geometries can carry shear stresses up to a certain magnitude across their interface before they start sliding. This behavior is called as sticking. So if we talk in simple words, the surfaces that are allowed to slide by a user defined value of coefficient of friction. Coefficient of friction is mu. So if there is some user defined value, if you want to allow the sliding by some user defined value of coefficient of friction, you can use a frictional contact. This is like a real-time condition where two surfaces slide against each other, and the sliding will always occur after the resistance value of mu is achieved. So once if you say that the frictional coefficient is 0.5, the sliding will occur after the 0.5 resistance is achieved, okay? And this will always give us the real time effects. It will be like a real condition where two surfaces are sliding against each other, okay? Next contact is frictionless. This setting models standard unilateral contact, that is normal pressure equals to zero if separation occurs. That means surfaces are allowed to slide freely where the coefficient of friction, that is mu, is zero. So in frictional contact you can give some user defined value for mu, but if you consider frictionless, the surfaces are sliding against each other but it is free sliding, and the mu, that is the coefficient of friction, is zero, and the contact can open and close depending on the loading condition. That means if you have applied a frictionless contact between the two plates and if the load applied on the two plates can cause some separation, they will separate. If the load can cause some sliding, it will slide, okay? Thus, in this condition or in this type of contact, even gaps can occur over here. That means on two surfaces, on whatever two surfaces you are applying a frictionless contact, there gaps can also occur. And this type of contact is generally used while performing non-linear analysis. Please understand, this is generally used when we are performing non-linear analysis. And the last type of contact is rough contact. This contact is similar to frictionless setting and it models a perfectly rough frictional contact where there is no sliding. But here what happens is the surfaces that are allowed to separate, even if you are saying that there is no sliding, the surfaces can separate from each other. That means in this contact the coefficient of friction that we consider is generally infinite. That means mu is equal to infinite, it can be infinite. So these are the types of contacts that we have in ANSYS workbench, okay?